Okay. Well, welcome in the name of Christ. We got bells right here in front of us. Okay. Thank you, Sue. Hi. Okay. We got bells coming up. We got spaghetti boiling downstairs. And I know that Dale, and Dale is right here. Wave, Dale. There he is. I know that Dale was cooking sauce, and so he's got very delicate feelings. I know different things were falling in the sauce while he was cooking. Don't question anything you find, you know, but you win a prize if it's alive. Yes?
It's almost my birthday.
It's almost your birthday. Almost, wait. How old are you?
Eight.
Going to be 8 years old.
No, I'm going to be
9 years old, okay. Because I am thinking about birthdays. I am thinking about birthdays. And I believe there's a man. An average man. Yes, you're right. I'm excited about it too. An average man who is unassuming and would prefer not to be recognized because he would find it embarrassing, right? And you know me, I hate to embarrass people. Brother Bowledge is it today your birthday? Yes, thank you very much. Is it your birthday today? Today, and from what I understand, you're 43 today, which is interesting because you have a son that looks amazingly good for his age. together, let's sing. Anybody else's birthday? You got your birthday coming up. You've got your birthday. Your birthday pass, that's close enough. My birthday is, your birthday's coming up. All right, so let's sing happy birthday to all our little birthday friends. So, happy birthday. And understand, we have just established an important tradition. You may not even know it. The tradition is when Rose Mader comes into church, we have to sing happy birthday. Well, we've got a few announcements of which I'd like you to take note. The ones in the bulletin, yes, Linda. All right. We've got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. We got a lot of stuff going on next Sunday. As some of y'all know, the community, the Weirton community, always has a Veterans Day service. And we do Veterans Day on November 11th. 11th hour, because that's when the armistice was signed to end World War I. And this is an important year. Why is this an important November 11th?
Centennial.
Because it's centennial. 100 years ago, on November 11th, the armistice was signed to end World War I. And that happens to be next Sunday. And I confirmed, Debbie, it with George this morning, that the service is going to be next door at the community center, 11 o'clock on next Sunday. 11 o'clock next Sunday. Now, since we generally worship at 11 o'clock, we decided to move the service to 10 o'clock. So that, yeah, I'm excited too. Sammy, you are in this. We moved it to 10 o'clock so that you can attend worship. You don't have to choose. You can attend worship here and then go next door and recognize our veterans. And would just, and I hadn't planned on this, but just out for my sake, would all you veterans stand up right now? Would veterans stand up? Okay. Now these, give them a round of applause. These are the guys we're going to recognize. These are the guys we're going to recognize next week. I want you to plan to come to church at 10 o'clock. We're going to have a patriotic, service-oriented service, about 45 minutes. And then we're going to, if you're able, we'll go together next door and be involved in the community service. And remember, it's appropriate for us because Cove is one of the groups that presents a wreath. So let's all be there for that. Now, we've also got we've got a special grief share seminar next Sunday at 3 o'clock, Surviving the Holidays. And so if you know anybody that may benefit from a little program on how, you know, they can kind of get through the grief in a very difficult time of year, please plan to, if it applies to you, come next Sunday to the seminar. If it applies to somebody else, please invite them. One other thing, and then I'll let some other people give announcements. We want to also, if you're contributing to Operation Christmas Smile, we are making the final collection and dedication next Sunday. So we'll be dedicating it at 10 o'clock. Those boxes that'll go overseas. So you might want to get, if you've got a box, bring it to the church. If you want a box, and can fill it in the next week. We've got boxes available in the lobby. Now, yes, Chris.
At Project Christmas Smile, I went to, Athena, Santa Clara, and they were very generous. They were very wonderful. So if you're in the need for any little children's outfits for ballerina or tumbling, excellent place to get it. And ladies, they have gowns from $50, she said, to $300, marked down to $50. So very inexpensive, a wide selection. So if you could support them, it would be wonderful. They were wonderful to us.
Maggie, give them applause. Now, Maggie, you heard that. $300 gowns for $50. Yeah, I that'll make a difference. Yes. Thank you. Anything else? Yes. Yeah.
Okay, yesterday we had scouting for and I would like to tell you that the Cub Scouts selected 1,019 items of food and
Hey, what, and are you finished with, because we've got a couple of Cub Scouts who were here collecting, right? Hey, would you guys stand up?
Yay!
So thank you, and a lot of people in the community, thank you, because it's going to feed a lot of folks. You, Katie, let me, you have, man, let me see. I gotta see this. Look at this. Katie, how long have you been playing with tow trucks? I I think that's a... But you're not a kind of a skull-looking gal. It's kind of surprised me that you have a skull on your truck.
I'm four.
You're four. Congratulations. Give me five. Good. Yes.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas is on the way. Brothers and sisters. Yes.
She didn't hear what John said.
What did John say?
She stole your pretzels.
All right. Yeah. Peggy. Boy, we got controversy here. All right. Yeah. Brothers and sisters, unless anybody's found any other trucks in the pew. Yes, Chris, about VAST. Yeah.
Better support groups on the 14th. I would love everybody that could attend. It's not just about your individual needs. As a group, we can help meet other people's needs too. And we all have a little bit of knowledge and insight that can help each other. So if you would like to make time for that, I appreciate it. Thank you.
14th, right?
Yes, sir.
At 6 o'clock? 6 o'clock, 14. Brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship Him together. Take your position. We're going to, even though the bulletin has another hymn, we're going to be singing right now, and the Janice is going to play the organ. The bells are going to ring their chimes. Let's sing with joy and enthusiasm. Come, ye thankful Christians, come. Hey, you ignore what's on the screen.
Hymn number 89.
Thank you.
Very good, ladies and gentlemen. Very good. Thank you. Oops. I broke you. I broke your clip. And it looked like an expensive one.
$75.
Well, we come to the part of the service where we've got the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. Now, we've got all kinds of concerns here on the insert, of which you may want to take note. I will say, as you see, our brother Ray Seifert isn't with us. Because he is, went to the hospital last Sunday. He's had some heart issues. They put in a stent. He is now recovering in the hospital. And since Ray, when I saw Ray, he's not a person who likes to take time off and be away. He has accumulated like 15,000 sick days in his school career. So he can take a nice long rest. But he's at the hospital at Weirton Medical on the 9th floor and 908. And don't worry, the 9th floor is no longer the psychiatric floor. So we're not covering for something else that's going on. But he's recovering. But we want to continue to pray for our brother Ray. Any other concerns or updates? Yeah.
A friend of my daughter's from way back in school. Pray for her. Her name is Sandra Locke.
Sandra Locke.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
We want to lift her up in prayer. Also want to pray for our sister, thank you, for our sister Beth Huey, who has had some surgery this past week at McGee's. So we want to lift her up in our prayers. Other needs or concerns? Yeah. Francis, we will definitely lift her up in our prayers. Thank you. And we want to certainly continue to pray for your husband. You know, keep him up high in our prayers. Anything else? Yes, Rose.
My great nephew was born on November 1st, and he has a very bad so he's already scheduled for surgery. I'm not sure when it is, but I think this is the beginning of some little developments that he's going to have. So keep him in our prayers.
For a young person, he's going to be dealing with a lot of stuff. So we want to lift him. You said your great-nephew? Your great-nephew up in our prayers. Okay. Well, with these, yes?
Continue for Victor, the gentleman that I work with.
Okay.
He's got some kidney issues that they can't figure out, so he needs to have some MRIs and various things, but he's still coming to work, so.
That's a good thing.
Yeah, that's a good thing.
That really is a good thing. So we want to continue to lift Victor up in our prayers. Thank you. Well, with these in mind and also the concerns we know ourselves, we're going to go to God now in prayer. Now, part of our prayer will be confession because we're getting ready to hear God's word. We need to clean ourselves out a little bit, and I'll pray that. And then you all will have the opportunity to lift your concerns to God, and we will close with the Lord's Prayer together. So, as God's people united by grace and the Holy Spirit, let's go to God now in prayer. Lord God, before we say anything else, we got to thank you for giving us the opportunity to be together this morning. It is a wonderful privilege to gather in your name. We heard people to whom you've given gifts, to the ability to play the bells, and of course the organ. We're just grateful, Lord, that you blessed us with so many wonderful things. Now, in just a little bit, we're going to hear your word read and proclaimed. But before we do that, there's something that we need to confess. It's kind of a continuation of what we were thinking about last week. You see, sometimes we get it in our head that we are really much smarter than we actually are. You know, that we think we know an awful lot of stuff. We have an awful lot of answers. And this arrogance is kind of moves us off track as we approach you. For example, and you know this because you see it, Christians are always running around trying to find you, or that they found you when you were never lost. You know you weren't lost. They were. But they still assume that they've done it, and they take great pride in doing it. In fact, their pride is so great, they stop looking because they assume whatever it is they found is enough. And when they do that, not only is it speaking to, when we do this, not only is it speaking to an arrogance that's really not godly, but it also leads us to miss the enormous grace and love and mercy that surrounds us all the time. We completely miss your truth, either trying to find you or worshiping those little images that we do find. So, Lord God, when we do that kind of stuff, forgive us. Just plain forgive us and refocus our attention, not on ourselves and what we're able to do, but rather on your grace and what you've already done for us. Help us to see that in the name of Christ. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're going to lift up to you those needs that are on that insert. And we're going to lift up to you and lay right in front of you all those things that weigh heavy on our hearts. Lord God, hear us as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us. And of course, thank you for loving us as much as you do. But right now, we thank you for forgiving us. And we thank you for responding to our needs, because we know we've been forgiven. And we know you will respond, because we've confessed these sins and lifted these needs in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray praying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Would you all come forward to collect our offering? I'll tell you guys, I think you were right on the mark. Let's give Janice a round of applause. Because Janice, that was some pretty fancy organ playing. Some pretty fancy organ playing. So thank you so much. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you for giving us the opportunity again to gather here in your name. Guide and direct the leaders of this congregation that these are gifts may be put to good and effective use. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Y'all may be seated. Now, I don't remember who it was, but somebody gave me really, really strict instructions that I, is right, that I was supposed to make this sermon short. Can you believe it, Debbie? Can... You know, it hurts me, but what can I do? Well, you know, you may want a short, but it's not because you're tired, right? Because everybody here should be well rested. Am I not right? Because we got the opportunity to do something last night that we only have the opportunity to do once a year, right? And it's to fall back. And I'll tell you, I look forward to it every single year. That falling back, because magically, an extra hour was what? Created. I mean, it just came from nowhere, right? It just appeared. And that's a wonderful thing. Now understand that I blew that extra hour yesterday morning when I got to work an hour later than I usually do. But understand, I'm not complaining because there's still an hour that I got, right? An extra hour. And I'll be doing plenty of complaining on March 11th of next year when we do what? Spring ahead or spring forward. And you know, I'll tell you, when you say spring forward, spring ahead, that sounds exciting, doesn't it? Spring forward. It's not all that exciting, right? Well, be that as it may, today we are here and we're going to hear the second message in this series about what we believe as children of the Calvinist Reformation. The Reformation in Geneva. And we talked about it last week, this Calvinism, these ideas, really come down to one word, because the first letter in each of them spell out the word tulip. And the ideas in the five ideas we're talking about are total depravity, makes you feel good about life, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, perseverance of the saints. And since this is the second week we've done this, last week we must have talked about what? What did we talk about last week?
Depravity.
Depravity. Not talking about last weekend. You know, just talking about last week, right? We talked about total depravity. And do you remember what we said about total depravity? That total depravity really involves, let me tell you what it doesn't involve. It doesn't involve human beings being really, really sinful. Being, you know, rotten to the core. Being bad seeds. That's not what total depravity means. Total depravity really has to do with holiness. And it involves the fact that we as people simply aren't God. We just are not God. That's what total depravity involves. And that's one of those duh statements. I mean, clearly we're not God, because God is limitless and perfect. And when you look at our lives are constantly bounded by all kinds of limitations, right? And no matter how hard we try, deep down we know that our wisdom and our knowledge and certainly our patience and our love, well, they're imperfect at the very best. I mean, we are simply not God. And I think most people kind of realize that on the inside, that we're not God. But, you know, that doesn't stop us from assuming that we can find God, right? I love it when people talk about finding God. They're going out and find God, right? Because God is like a kid in a shopping mall, right? You know, somehow poor God got himself lost. And it's up to Ed Rudiger to do what? To find him. And he'll be there with the police officer, ice cream cone, so happy to be found, right? And that's what we start looking. And what makes it even worse, and we talked about this last week, when we start looking, even though we know we got limited knowledge, we assume that we can find a creator that is hidden. You know, we assume that we can do it. And in the end, we actually do find something, right? People go out and look at, they find something. The problem is, what's the problem? It ain't God, right? So instead of finding God as we look, we end up finding reflections of ourselves. That's what we find. You know, we find things that we may call God, or we may call Jesus, or we may call Allah, or we may call Buddha, or we may call Oprah Winfrey. We could call them anything we want, right? But they share our opinions and our values and our desires. They bless in the way we want to be blessed. They curse the folks we want cursed. They are reflections of ourselves. And since you can't come up with a better God than one that looks and acts like you, people stop looking, right? I mean, when you got the perfect God, if I got a God that looks like me, why would I look for another one? I have found it, right? In fact, I don't want to find another God. Mine is fine. I'll take mine. It's sort of like something the great philosopher Voltaire, great philosopher, around the time of the French, before the French Revolution, a little bit. Great philosopher Voltaire said, in the beginning, good biblical word, in the beginning, God created man in his image. And man has been trying to return the favor ever since. Of course. Because God just lets us do it. God doesn't stop us from doing something that stupid. We end up getting into all kinds of trouble. You know, like the Apostle Paul wrote to the Romans. We read a little bit of this last week. So God let these people go their own way. They did what they wanted to do, and their filthy thoughts made them do shameful things with their bodies. They gave up the truth. And this is what's really important. They gave up the truth about God for a lie, and they worshiped God's creation instead of God, who will be praised forever and ever. Now, that's total depravity. The fact that we do that and don't even recognize that we're doing it. It's like we're under this great big dome, and we're happy there because we got a God. Now, understand, when times get tough, that God that looks like me doesn't help much. But we're still happy when things are going okay, because that God generally tells me to do what I want to do, right? Okay. And so that's total depravity. This morning, we're going to consider what happens next. In other words, after the T, total depravity, we move to the U, unconditional election. And I'll tell you, we all know about elections, right? Because the one we're in is grinding to a conclusion on Tuesday. And brothers and sisters, hasn't it been an uplifting affair? Doesn't it make you feel good about humanity in general, this election? You know, right now, I can tell you without fear of contradictions, I know all the reasons why I shouldn't vote for either Patrick Morrissey or Joe Manchin. I know all the reasons why I shouldn't vote for him, right? And so on Tuesday, I'm left in a quadrant. You know, I'm there in the box, and I can either choose to vote against. Remember, we're voting against now, not for, but against. I can either go vote against the drug lobbyist from New Jersey who's trying to take away my health insurance, Or I can vote against the unusually tall yet minionly-like minion for Hillary Clinton and Nancy Pelosi, who hates coal miners. That's my choice. I get to vote against one of the two, right? Of course, that's not to say that there aren't other folks in other parts of our country that are excited about voting. In fact, other groups even in our country, in our state, that's excited. In fact, I was reading an article yesterday saying that some, and maybe y'all, somebody else read it too, some 18-year-olds are actually, because it'd be their first election, are actually planning to leave class, either college or high school, leave class in order to vote. And I think that's kind of interesting. Now, when I read it, I know that for some politicians, this is the best of all possible news, right? Because in their eyes, these young voters, man, they are enthused and they are informed and they are focused and they are looking for what's best in the country. Of course, for other politicians, they see these young adults in another way. They're going to be paying your Social Security. I'm just telling you. You see, regardless of their opinions, a whole bunch of people are going to vote. And the votes they make are going to determine the outcome of the election, right? Maybe. You know, the one who gets the most votes will win, depending on how many dead people vote. They're probably going to win. Now, that's what we're going to do on Tuesday. This morning, though, we're looking at a different kind of election. We're looking at God's election of us. And since it's called unconditional, and does anybody know what, can tell me what unconditional means? No restrictions. This is unconditional. It means that it's an election we don't control. In other words, if we applied it to the senatorial election, it would mean there's no reason for Patrick Morrissey to wear that plaid flannel shirt and pretend like he's comfortable with minors. Or for Joe Manchin to shoot a hole in a big pack of papers, which I'll tell you, I don't understand. Except that I guess he can fire a rifle, and his aiming bad, you know. No, the election we're talking about today isn't based on anything that we've done. This election is totally, totally, totally in the hands of God. And so as we talk about this unconditional election, we're going to focus on two things. We're going to focus on the nature of the one who's doing the electing. And second, we're going to sort of think about how it applies to us. And I'll tell you, for us to understand what God has done for us, man, I think it is really important to consider his nature. And in particular, how God in his very nature is perfect in two different ways. He's perfect in his freedom, and he's perfect in his love. And I think that's the first thing we need to understand. Now, remember, even earlier in this message, talked about it last week, early in this message, how we are not God. Right? I said, we are not God. Well, brothers and sisters, God is not us either. Because God is, what's the word? God is perfect. I mean, for one, he is perfect in his freedom. God is perfect in his freedom. In other words, he is free from all of those little petty limitations that we face all the time. Limitations like what? Body, you know, although my body is getting more omnipresent every day. You know, our bodies are limited, our minds are limited, right? Our lives are limited, our power is limited. God is free from those limits. For example, God is perfect in his power. And that's why we use the word omnipotent. You know, all powerful. It's like Job said. We read this passage, a little piece of this last week. Job said, no one can oppose you because you have the power to do what you want. Omnipotence. And right along with his limitless power, his unlimited power, God is also perfect in his knowledge. And that's what another word, another omni word. You know what it is? Omniscient. Omniscient. That's what omniscient means, all-knowing. The psalmist wrote, "You have looked deep into my heart, Lord, and you know all about me. You know when I am resting or when I am working. And from heaven you discover my thoughts. You notice everything I do and everywhere I go. Before I even speak a word, you know what I will say." See, I thought that only applied to Debbie. And now I know it applies to God. You see, God is omniscient. And I'll tell you, just like he's all-powerful and all-knowing, I said that because she's not here right now. Yeah, I appreciate that. He's also perfect in his presence. And that's what omnipresent means. In other words, God is present everywhere. The prophet, great prophet Jeremiah, understand he's speaking for God here. He says, "I am everywhere, both near and far, in heaven and on earth. There are no secret places where you can hide from me." You see, God is perfect in his freedom, and that's one. And two, he's also perfect in his love. Perfect in his freedom, also perfect in his love. For instance, God's grace is perfect. This is what the Apostle Paul said. "Three times I appealed to you, to the Lord, about this, that you would leave me, or that it would leave me. But you said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you. For power is made perfect in weakness, so I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weakness, weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong." You see, God is perfect in his grace. And God is also perfect in his mercy. It's like the psalmist wrote, "Each generation will announce to the next your wonderful and powerful deeds. I will keep thinking about your marvelous glory and your mighty miracles. Everyone will talk about your fearsome deeds, and I will tell all nations how great you are. They will celebrate and sing about your matchless mercy and your power to save." You see, not only is his grace perfect, so is his mercy. And I'll tell you, so is his patience. And that's good for us, right? That God is a patient God. And this is something Peter understood, because this is what he said in his second letter. "Dear friends, don't forget that for the Lord, one day is the same as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is the same as one day. The Lord isn't slow about keeping his promises, as some people think he is. In fact, God is patient because he wants everyone to turn away from sin and no one to be lost." And so there it is. The nature of God. Something that a great theologian named Karl Barth called the divine perfections. The divine perfections of God. For one, God is what? God is perfect in his... What did I just say? God is one. God is perfect in his love, right? And God is perfect in his freedom. You feel free to talk in church. You know, you can you can say, like I said before, this is Presbyterian. No one will confuse us for Pentecostals just speaking out loud. You know, when you look at Presbyterians, answer like this. Yeah, that's right. That's a Presbyterian filled by the Spirit. Okay, I only say it because it's true. Okay. All right, so God is perfect in his freedom. God is perfect in his love. And I'll tell you, because he's perfect in both, that's why he's able to be the source of our unconditional election. And that's the second thing I believe we got to keep in mind if to understand this idea. And you see, I want you to think of it in a... and kind of a special way, it's right there on the slide. I want you to think about it in terms of how God loves us in freedom. God loves us in freedom. But let's break that down just a little bit. First, God, what? How does God feel about us? God loves us. Okay, God loves us. We said he's perfect in love. That's fine. But God's not just perfect in love. God loves... I feel like I'm leaning forward. Loves who?
Everybody.
Oh, thank you very much. That was painful. As the psalmist wrote, your love is a treasure and everybody finds shelter in the shadow of your wings. You give your guests a feast in your house and you serve a tasty drink that flows like a river. Now, this is really cool, right? That God loves us. You feel good about it?
Amen.
Say, yeah, let's say amen. You feel good about it. If you feel good about it, let's say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, you feel good about it. But you know something? I'm going to give you something that makes it even better. God's love for us isn't grounded on anything that we have done or said or thought or promised. Wow. God's love isn't about our hearts or our heads or our hands or any other internal organs you want to give to God. God isn't about us. You see, God doesn't love me because of me. God doesn't love me because of me. I'll tell you, that's how we love. You see, our love is what I call object-centered love. We love the characteristics or the nature of the things and people we love, right? For example, I love Maggie. I love my daughter. I love my daughter Maggie because she's my daughter. But I hate collard greens, right? Because collard greens are given by the devil. Let's get right down to it. You see, our feelings about, our love about something is grounded in the characteristic of the thing that we love. That's object-centered love. But God's love isn't object-centered. God's love is subject-centered love. Subject-centered love. For instance, let me show you what that means. I want somebody here, somebody who is really brave. Who is really brave? Give me somebody who's really, really great. Now I feel like I'm teaching school again. Yeah, I want you to be somebody really, really, really bold. Oh, they're pointing at you, John. You know, really bold. John, would you do me a favor? Would you stand up? Okay. Would you stand up? And I want you to do something for me, standing up. And by the way, you do look really good. For your age. I want you to ask me a question. Can you ask me a question?
Yes.
Okay. This is a question I want you to ask me. Why does God love you and me?
Why does God love you and me?
What a dumb question. No, that's fine. Why does God love you and me? Bango! Why does God love you and me? God, what? Read it together. Let's read it together. God is what?
Love.
God is love. Oh, you can sit down if you want. God is love. And anyone who doesn't love others has never known God. Real love isn't our love for God, but his love for us. Why does God love us? Let me hear it. Because God is love. God is love. That's subject-centered love. You see, God doesn't love us because of us. And man, we should be happy about that. Because, you know, we're kind of limited, right? And we do things that are just plain stupid. God doesn't love us because of us. God loves us because of God. Man, that's what he does. In fact, because God's love is subject-centered, because God loves, because God is love, he's able to love us when we are really unlovable. As Paul wrote to the Romans, Christ died for us at a time when we were helpless and sinful. You know, Christ didn't die for us when we finally got good. He died for us when we were at our what?
Worst.
When we are helpless. No one is really willing to die for an honest person, though someone might be willing to die for a truly good person. But God showed how much he loved us by having Christ die for us even though we were sinful. Paraphrasing a minister that I knew 30 years ago, we are going to have to learn to live with the fact that God loves us. And there is nothing we can do about it. At least in terms of changing that love. We cannot cause God to turn against us. God loves us because God is love. And I'll tell you, it's because of this love that God chose us. And see, choosing is what election is all about. As Paul wrote to the Ephesians, before the world was created, God had Christ choose us. Before the world was created, God had Christ choose us to live with him and to be his holy and innocent people and loving people. God was kind and decided that Christ would choose us to be God's own adopted children. God was very kind to us because of the Son he dearly loves and so that we could praise God. God loves us. And out of that love, he chooses us. And that love is shown by God's desire to have a relationship with us. And I'm talking with all of us. It's like Jesus said to Nicodemus in the Gospel of John when the Pharisee came to visit him. This is part of what Jesus said. God loved the people of this world so much that he gave his only son so that everyone who has faith in him will have eternal life and never really die. God did not send his son into the world to condemn its people. He sent him to save them. God loves us and really wants us to love him back. And that's one. But you know, second, that love he has for us, man, that love is not worth a bucket of spit if God lacks freedom. And I'm talking about the power and the knowledge and the presence to do something about that love. When I was in junior high, I loved this girl. I really did. Sue, do you believe me?
Yes.
Oh, I did. You know, they would call it, there's a term, because she lived right around the block, and when I was going to Rosemont Junior High, I used to walk there, and she would walk, and gosh, there's a term. They call that now, what?
Stalking.
Yeah, I used to stalk her, because, yeah, I used to hang out outside her house, and I would follow her, and she would try to ditch me, but I persevered because I what? Loved her. But you know what I lacked? That was loaded with love. You know what I lacked? The power. Yeah, brains. Thank you, Sandy. I lacked the brains and the good looks to do anything about it. You know, I lacked the power. I had the love, but I lacked the power. I lacked the freedom. And the good news for us is that God has it. You see, God is free. God is free to act. You know, to reach down, to invite us into his presence. God has the authority. And I think that's exactly why Paul wrote what he did to the Romans. And y'all who know me know this is my favorite passage in all of Scripture. This is it. What can we say about this? If God is on our side, can anyone be against us? God did not keep back his own son, but gave him for us. If God did this, won't he freely give us everything else? Duh. If God says his chosen ones are acceptable to him, can anyone bring charges against them? No. Or can anyone condemn them? No, indeed. Christ died and was raised to life. And now he is at God's right hand speaking to him for us. Can anything separate us from the love of Christ? Can trouble, suffering, danger, and death? In everything, we have won more than a victory. Because of Christ who loves us. I am sure that nothing can separate us from God's love. not life or death, not angels or spirits, not the present or the future, not powers above or powers below. Nothing in all creation can separate us from God's love for us in Christ Jesus our Lord. Close the book.
Elvis
has left the building. There's no but at the end of that. There's no if. There's no when. The sentence is done. And so is the chapter. And brothers and sisters, that's exactly what God has done for us. He has loved us in His freedom. And I'll tell you, that's remarkable. I mean, in spite of the fact that we are always wandering off, in spite of the fact that we are always chasing and trying to find other gods, in spite of the fact that we get ourselves in all kinds of trouble when we do dumb and stupid things, God still loves us. God still chooses us. And because His freedom has no limits, He has the authority to do something about it. We are God's children, whether we want to be or not. We really are. Of course, there's a little problem, right? Talked about relationships a little bit earlier. For a relationship to exist, can it be one-sided? I learned that when the policeman was talking to me, you know, on the way to junior high one morning. For a relationship to exist, it's got to be two-sided, right? And remember, what are we doing? We are still worshiping the little idols we've created that have mirrors for faces. Therefore, we don't even recognize what God has done, much less appreciate it. In other words, although He loves us, who do we love?
Us.
We love ourselves and the gods that we create. We're not going to love Him back. But that's going to change. Because this issue is not a problem for God. God can take care of this. In fact, in 2 weeks, 2 weeks from now, we're going to talk about how God, at least part of how God, takes care of this problem and brings God's love to us right close and personal when we look at the L in the word TULIP, limited atonement, the way that God bridges the gap. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank You so much for giving us this opportunity to hear Your Word. Lord, help us just appreciate how incredible Your love is. That Your unconditional election is something that we should feel, we should marvel at. Should make us feel all kinds of joy and enthusiasm. Because it's not something that we have worked for and earned. It is not something that we have found and hold and gotten. Whether it's something that You've given. And since it's a gift, it's not something that we can lose. Help us to appreciate the power of the gift. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Now, before we stand and close this service by singing a song that will be up on the screen, let me offer you this invitation. If anybody here might feel the grace of Jesus Christ, talk to me after the service over a plate of spaghetti would be nice. If you've got questions about the sermon or the service, talk to me about that as well. Nothing gives me more pleasure than talk about Scripture and God and that kind of jazz. Okay, so let's all stand and let's close the service by singing a song that I think is really appropriate for this morning. It'll be up on the screen. God Loves You. Now the words are also in the bulletin if you can't see it on the screen. Brothers and sisters, go now in peace. Maybe not too far. We got spaghetti downstairs. So head downstairs, get yourself a plate of spaghetti. And I challenge you this week, I challenge you to remember one thing. One thing. That's it. What do you think it is?
God loves us.
God loves us. And to empower that, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.